Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
I am really honored to be here and to have been invited by Shabazz Wilson and Clemson Brown. I haven't been in New York in a long time, but I'm thrilled to be here. And happy birthday.
Thank you.
And many more. I'm going to, as usual, talk about racism, white supremacy. My mother is deceased, but one time she said to me, "What are you going to talk about, Francis?" And I said, "Mother, you know I only talk about racism." And she said, "Well, can't you talk about something different?" But everything is racism, and I want to talk about it. I'm a general psychiatrist and child psychiatrist practicing in Washington, D.C. And I have arrived at the point where I feel that the most important thing that we as black people need to understand is this powerful dynamic of racism. Those of you who are familiar with the work of Neely Fuller know that he has said, if you do not understand white supremacy racism, what it is and exactly how it works, everything else that you think you understand will only confuse you. So I believe that if we are going to move further into the 21st century and into the 22nd century and into the 23rd century, that we have to have clear insight as to what this process is all about. I think it's in the book of Isaiah. If you do not have, those who do not have a vision, if there's no vision, the people will perish. I guess that's, if there is no vision, the people will perish. Meaning we have to have a more global understanding of exactly what the forces are on this planet so we can actually do short-range planning as well as long-range planning. I started thinking about racism when I was doing a residency in general psychiatry at St. Elizabeth's Hospital in Washington, D.C. And it was a program that was based on Freudian psychoanalytic theory, and nothing was really being said about the mental health of black people. I'm a third generation physician. My father was a physician. His father was a physician. And my parents told us that you are getting an education not to leave your community. You are getting an education in order to help your community. So the black patients that I would talk to and take a history on, within the history of every black patient would be aspects and dimensions of racism. And when I was an undergrad, I considered myself to be a Marxist. I thought that economics was causing racism, that it was a means for economic exploitation. Well, you can have ideas as an undergrad, but when you are a physician and responsible for the care of patients, you really have to know what you're talking about. I remember going home when I was an undergrad. You know, my parents and my grandmother were sitting at the dining room table, and I announced, "I'm a Marxist." And my grandmother said, "The more education they get, the dumber they get." But anyway, talking to patients and seeing this gigantic monster in the middle of their history about racism, I said, "I've got to really understand racism in depth." And the training program that I was in, it was at a federal government hospital. All the people in charge of the training program were white people. And they actually taught us there were a few black residents, I think 3 out of 12, that black people did not have the intellectual potential to benefit from psychotherapy. That the best treatment for black people was medication. Well, that did not compute for me. So I said out to myself, I want to understand really more about racism. I happened to have been at a social gathering, and these were black people sitting around after a Black Power Committee meeting. And I heard a gentleman across the room say, racism is a system. It was almost like a light bulb going on. That was Neely Fuller. How many of you are familiar with his work? I consider him to be one of the critical thinkers in our group in the 20th century and into the 21st century. He was saying that racism is a system, and let me, because we got to get this really in our heads. He said it was a system, and the system functions in all areas of people activity, economics, education, entertainment, labor, law, politics, religion, sex, and war. And that the purpose of this system is to maintain the power equation of white over non-white, white power over non-white powerlessness. And so I thought this was a very profound concept. Those of you who are familiar with the work of Dr. Du Bois in 1903 said that the problem of the 20th century is the question of the color line. This is the problem of the color line. So I said to myself, why would a system for the purpose of maintaining white power over non-white powerlessness, why would such a system evolve on this particular planet, planet Earth? And then I thought about some of the things that are said within the system. One of the critical things is that we are taught that white is a majority. Is that right? And we are told that non-white is genetic inferior. And then I just thought about the things that, you know, you learn going to school for a long time and going to medical school. I said, wait a minute, white is a tiny minority. Fewer than 1/10 of the people on the planet have white skin. And instead of black people being genetically inferior, the ability to produce this black pigment, melanin, is a genetically dominant trait. And we have an excellent example in our president, Barack Obama. His mother is white, was white, his father was black. And you mix these together, and what do you get?
Obama.
See, always a black person. So I said that, okay, on this planet, planet Earth, in the 15th century, we had Columbus, 1492, coming out of Europe and realizing that the earth was round and not flat. And everywhere these white people landed, they found colored people, right? And if those men were sexually frustrated, and the people were overtime, and the women had sex, or I should say the men had sex, imposed sex, however you want to look at it. If they waited around 9 months, they found that all of the children looked like the mothers. And so they realized, wait a minute, we are a tiny minority in Europe and no other place where there are white people. So they said, wait a minute, what if these men got in votes and started going from south to north? We could genetically disappear. Now, this may not make sense to black people, because under white supremacy, black people try to get rid of their color, don't we? White people don't want to disappear. And I have asked audiences of white people, do you want your children to be colored? Do you want your grandchildren to be colored? Do you want your great-grandchildren to be colored? Do you want your great-great-great-great-great-grandchildren to be colored? I'm polite and they're polite. What do they say?
No.
Meaning they don't want to disappear. So I said, if you mean this, then you have to do certain specific things in all of these areas of activity so that white does not disappear on planet Earth. Now, unbeknownst to us, this is the critical underlying motivation for all of the behavior of people who classify themselves as white on this planet. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the name Tom Metzger. He was one of the arch white supremacists or white separatists. Some years ago, I was on a television program in Los Angeles when President Reagan's son had a television talk show. And so this particular show was a panel of people, might have been 10 people, talking about race and racism. I just happened to be sitting next to Mr. Metzger. And so during a commercial break, I kind of touched him on his arm. I'm sitting right next to him. And he didn't say, don't touch me, nigger. I said, Mr. Metzger, tell me something. What percentage of people who classify themselves as white are fearful of white genetic annihilation? And he answered very politely. He said, Dr. Welsing, nearly all of them. But they are ashamed or afraid to admit it. Now, I can understand that. In other words, this system is about white genetic survival. Now, if some people have organized a system for their genetic survival, what's the chance that they're going to give that system up? None. See, they worked hard. And we can consider it unjust. It's the most unjust system that has ever been devised on the planet, where you have one-tenth of the people deciding that they need to control nine-tenths of the people on the planet. But all along, I maintain, we have not understood this. We thought when we were formerly enslaved, if they would just take off the chains, everything everything is going to be okay. So they removed the chains, and then what did they do next? They put laws in place to accomplish the same thing. And we went through the 1960s in what is being called the Civil Rights Era. And the black people, with all of their dignity and their pride and their courage, going up against horses and hoses and dogs to get the vote, to get that change, coming out of that movement, saying black pride, black is beautiful, black power, black self-respect. And the people who had something else in mind said that's dangerous. If people are talking about self-respect and dignity, then I encourage everybody to look at the films Eye on the Prize and look at those black people, men and women and children, going up against a horrific force. But they were determined and they had their self-respect with them. But the system said, this is dangerous. If we let these people go forward, talking about black pride, black dignity, black is beautiful, we will be in trouble. So we have to have something for them. And I maintain that's when they decided, well, we have to feed them images of Superfly, prostitutes, pimps selling drugs, men kicking women, all kind of language. Following that up into the present with having black people call themselves niggers and dogs, and gangsters and thugs and bitches and hoes. Now, once that's in the brain computer, you can do anything. See, that's the complete annihilation of self-respect. Now, we didn't understand it. We thought, oh, this is just entertainment. Like the movie Monster Ball, or the movie Precious, do you see, or the movie for colored girls. See, because we don't have a clue. We don't have a clue about what is going on. See, we've been thinking. And God bless Dr. Martin Luther King, a minister but a great political scientist. He said it's about love. Everybody should love. And he got killed. And I say the reason being that if everybody on the planet, all these people, white, non-white, love, and the love was expressed in sexual activity, what would happen? White would disappear. Do you see? So kill him, because that would mean our genetic disappearance. So if the system is a violence, white genetic survival, what do they have to worry about most? Okay, give him a B plus. Black men, white women. Okay, but let's even take it further. In that, if the concern is white genetic survival, The reason being is that men, males, whether they're white, black, brown, red, or yellow, can impose sexual intercourse. If I would, you know, try to impose sexual intercourse on any of the gentlemen here, and they said, I'm sitting next to my wife, and I went to my purse, and I got my Uzi. And I frightened the man. What's going to happen?
It's not going to work.
I hope everybody got that. The erection cannot be maintained in the presence of fear. So females cannot impose sexual intercourse, you know, like ultimately, what? Frighten the man. Now, the Creator made that possible so somebody, if they were in danger, they wouldn't be in conflict. You see, it's fear. I mean, fear about unemployment could cause a man to have erection problems. Are you all with me?
Yeah.
So, there's a reason that if the concern is genetic survival, and see, we are decoding this material. Because we have thought somehow there's some white people who are going to work with us. Sometimes we thought it was Republicans, sometimes we thought, you know, with Lincoln, and sometimes Democrats. But even President Obama is finding out. It could be Republicans or Democrats. But if it's a black man that they're being asked to support, they start jumping ship. Because the test for white people, see, they, in other words, they work 24/7. They don't sleep. They got three shifts going. See, we work one shift and then go to bed and then party. They work 24/7. About maintaining the conditions for their survival. You see, because it is very serious to them. And if they have some people who classify themselves as white, who start looking like they're getting out of line, what's the question that they ask? Are you a nigger lover? Are you with us or are you with them? Now, this is a fundamental question that has to do with the issue of their survival. So that we cannot depend on communists, conservative liberals, greens, libertarians. And see, this is not a lecture about hate white people. It is a lecture about understanding the opposition. And one of the best analogies to have in mind is the game of chess. See, what is the game of chess about?
Strategy.
Those are nice BC answers.
Black
is white. Tell them about
black
king. Conquering the king, white is right.
It's about white king, checkmate, black king. White always moves first. So white is playing what? Offense, defense, and black has to play defense. This is what we have now. This is distressing to a lot of people because we wanted to believe. As we were even programmed to believe in the area of religion. See, I don't know how many of you, I'm a little bit older than many, but if you went to Sunday school, my grandfather was chairman of the deacon and trustee board, so we were in Sunday school before we could see straight. think they didn't learn that God was white? See, if you were given that little Sunday school card with a white picture of Jesus, your brain automatically concluded that his father had to be white. His father could not have been black. Now, if he was a historic figure, he was black. Even Billy Graham said that Jesus could not have been white. But we are programmed to think that Jesus was white, and therefore his father is white. And we were taught to sing, Jesus, translate white man, loves the little children. All the little children of the world, red, yellow, black, and white, all are precious in his sight. How many know that song? Boy, no more church going in these days. There was a time when everybody knew those basic songs. You see, but being taught that God is white, and they got a musical that came out some time ago, Arms Too Short to Box with God. Meaning arms too short to box with the white man. See, when I was a little child, having seen the Sunday school card with Jesus on it, I had just drawn my own conclusion that the man on the Quaker Oats box must be God. See, he was somewhat older with white hair. Jesus was younger, so you know, now we thank him for the food. We just had this big Quaker Oats box in the pantry. I mean, that was my conclusion. But if you, any of you, saw a Sunday school card with the white Jesus, your brain jumped to that conclusion too without your knowing it. That's called a subconscious conclusion. This was deeply programmed in our thinking, but I tell people that the truth is, you cannot hide it. That it will come out in material. It will come out through the subconscious. Because if we break the name Jesus down in Ebonics, it spells just us. That's who we're waiting for, right? Just us to get our heads together. Now I say that as black people, we greet each other a zillion times a day. We're saying, hey, what's happening? What's happening? What's happening? Because we don't know what's going on. See, we keep running into a wall and wondering how come things haven't worked out, because we have been deceived. We have been told we are in a democracy where everybody is equal. The truth and the reality is that we are in a system of racism, white supremacy. See, we're told that the system of democracy has imperfections. No, we are in a system of white supremacy that has been perfected. And that's why we keep staying basically in the same position. And as long as we don't understand we're dealing with a system, every week we just complain another black man has been shot, another black man has been killed. You say, oh, 10 over there, 3 over there. Oh, well, let's add up the statistics and somebody will run and complain about it. But if it's happening over and over again, that implies intentionality. And if the system is about white genetic survival, who is the enemy of the state? No. Black man. In a war, if you can take care of the business as order to not worry about white genetic survival. The attack has to center on the black man. Now, years ago, in the 1970s, I was teaching at Howard University College of Medicine, and I would have Neely Fuller lecture every Monday night from 8 until 1 o'clock in the morning. And it would be students and people from the community. And Mr. Fuller used to talk about the system of racism, white supremacy, is going to have black men wearing dresses. And now this is 1970, about 72, 73. And that sounded so far out. Nobody, you know, what's he talking about? What has recently happened at Morehouse College? The president of Morehouse College had to announce and lay down the law that the black male students, those who were so inclined, could not wear high heel shoes, could not wear dresses and carry pocketbooks. Now this is 2010. That if the system, see, in other words, we have to keep system about white genetic survival. About. And the system is working 24/7. If I turn the black male into a female, can I relax about the fear of white genetic survival? Absolutely. Now I don't know what goes on here in New York. Haven't been here in a while. In D.C., we have a lot of men with their pants hanging down. In the train station, when I bought my ticket to come here, there's a black gentleman, had on some expensive clothes, had some nice luggage. His pants were down here. So he would pull the luggage like this as he got his ticket, and then he had to stop. Walk a few more steps. See, now, in other words, imagine somebody looking down from another galaxy or planet. You see, in other words, psychiatrists, behavior, all behavior has significance. You just have to understand the context and the power that is controlling it. Do you see what I'm saying? So, to understand what is happening, because what are we told? 70% of the households are without fathers. Read a book recently where a young black man is talking about having gotten into some difficulty doing a carjacking, carrying a gun at 16. And he said in the book, I had to go to prison to find my fathers. He said, fathers. He said, in prison was the first time he had an opportunity. Now, he didn't consciously put himself in that situation. But looking for fathers, I had a black male child say to me, you know, somebody brings a child to the psychiatrist because he's not studying or something. I had one child say to me who was about 10 or 11 years old, Dr. Welsing, I think I could do my homework if I just had an official father. Now that makes the psychiatrist want to fall under the desk and start crying. I had another child say, if I had a father, he could at least have taught me what goes on under the hood of a car. I had another child. All these children are brought into the psychiatrist because somebody says, teacher, principal, they're smart, but they won't do their homework. Or they won't study. This child came and I said, sweetheart, don't you want to work hard in school? This was years ago. So you can help black people. And this little boy said, no. He wasn't being smart alecky. He wasn't being rude. And I said, you know, the psychiatrist wants to hear the child say yes. He said, no. And I said, why not? He said, if you try to help black people, you're going to be killed. Now this is a little black child, about 11 years old, said Malcolm X, George Jackson. I said, IQ 265. If you try to help black people, you are going to be killed. Was he right? That's like President Barack Obama has had more death threats than any president in the history of the United States. You see, because just that presence of a black man in the White House, like I think a lot of white people who initially voted for him, wanted to appear liberal. Yeah. You see, but once he's in that White House, and a black man with a black wife, yeah, and a black grandmother, that's the whole package. They begin to understand, oh my God, if he's in power, and not only that, the reception that he receives all over the non-white world. You see, so they started shaking because people who classify themselves as white are not consciously carrying around in their mind fear of white genetic annihilation. They repress that. You see, but how do we know based on other behaviors that they engage in? And just like Tom Metzger said, the majority of white people are fearful of their genetic annihilation. Sometimes white people will say to me, Dr. Wilson, what can I do to help? And I say, tell black people what white people talk about when there's no black people around. They all go silent because what are they talking about? They're either talking directly or in code about white genetic survival. I had a white college professor say to me after I had been invited to speak at a prison, white university, giving educational programs in a prison, 100% of the prisoners black males. So I went and talked about the same thing I'm talking about here, about racism. So this white professor said to me, because she drove me out there, drove me back home. She said, see, sometimes when you push truth, and I'm not being rude and disrespectful, people feel compelled to come out with their truth. So she said, Dr. Wilson, you know, I hate to admit it, but on all social occasions, not some, not a few, on all social occasions when it's white people together and there's no black people around, she said, we are talking negative question is that everybody present is in agreement. So I told her that I understood that. See, they're simply talking code. They're just talking code about their survival. They are not going to reveal it. They'll just say to us, isn't it nice that we're in a democracy? You see, but they are talking code about their survival. And at the same time that a black man is in the White House, there are millions of people locked up in prison. Millions, thousands of black men locked up in prison. You can say the incarceration of black genetic material. Now I say that the system 24/7 is talking about this critical problem in activity that you would not think it's talking about white genetic survival. So one day, one Sunday, it was so quiet. I said, gee, what's happening? It was so quiet. See, when it's quiet, you can think. Yeah. And this is why they say, now this is your music. Boom, de boom, de boom. See, all that loud music turns off the brain computer because of sensory overload. See, they use loud music, our loud music, to torture people in Guantanamo. To torture people. To make them go crazy. But they feed it to us and say, this is your music. This is what we want you to hear. But and I said, what's going on? And it came to me, ball game. And I said to myself, for ball games to have a whole city be quiet, the ball games must have a significant an important significance that we're not generally focusing on. So it just pops. See, once you understand the context, meaning system of white supremacy or white genetic survival, this is the context in which everything, language, speech, activity takes place. So it just occurred to me, into my computer, there are two series of ball games in the system of what are the two series of ball games? See, you're looking at it all the time, but if you don't see the context, you won't see it, but you're looking at it. What are the two series of ball games? Computer subconscious. And this is not a man with glasses. See, why does this come into mind? Because this is a diagram of male genitalia. This is the phallus or the penis. These are the testicles. The testicles contain the genetic material. What are the testicles called, colloquially? Balls. See, I don't make up stuff. I just observe. Balls. So out of the same brain computer that set up a system of white supremacy comes to, see, this doesn't come out of our brain computer. It didn't have to. So the big brown balls mean the genetically dominant balls. And they are brown. And what are they? Football. Basketball. Basketball. Bowling ball. Earth ball. Small white marbles.
Long stick held between legs.
Now, anybody studying anatomy and female anatomy will understand. This is pubic hair. See, the ball happens to go in the rough. Or the ball can go in the water. See, the female genitalia, you have the vaginal opening, you have the urethra where the urine comes out, and you have the anus, and that's the sand trap. Are you all with me?
Yes.
I don't want to ruin anybody. We have got to understand racism and white supremacy. We have got to understand. And that's how a minority can control a majority on the planet. See, by words, by symbols. What about the game of... excuse me.
Tell them about the drill.
What about the game of village? Greenfield, long stick, triangle, whole lot of colored balls. See, the triangle is the female vaginal organ. Take the triangle off, and what's the game about? The white, long stick, white ball knocks all the colored balls under the table. And what ball is left on top of the
table?
The white ball. The black ball is the last ball to go in. See, we're doing too much partying and eating and not observing. The black ball is the last to be knocked in. And the expression is what? President Obama, you don't want to be caught where? Behind the eight ball. See, if you're behind the eight ball, that means that the black man is in power. You all following? Let's look at the password in the black community. At least it used to be. The people in New York, Brooklyn say motherfucker.
Yes.
Yes.
Still.
One day I came out of the clinic, and there were some young people passing, and they were the motherfucker. So my first reaction is, oh my God. The second reaction, if a word or a phrase is used with high frequency, there has to be a reason behind it. So I said to myself, in the system of racism, white supremacy, there are five people categories. Man, woman, boy, girl, baby. Who is the man? I say, here comes the man, you all. Why are you all so quiet?
The man.
Is the white man. Any other male has four choices. Black men call historically, don't call me no boy. Is that right?
Right.
The white supremacists say, okay, you got three choices. Woman, girl, or baby. It used to be that woman and girl were out. many black ladies have called a black man that they're highly familiar with baby? See, lying to yourself. You've read the book. How many gentlemen have called a lady that they're familiar with mama? Hey mama, can I ride with you? Let's get a witness. How many gentlemen have called a place where they sleep a crib?
Still do.
Man who calls himself baby calls a woman he sleeps with mama, calls a place where he sleeps a crib, will call himself what? A motherfucker.
Oh.
Are you all with me?
Yeah.
Now my mother, bless her soul, my mother was a Chicago public school teacher. So this is some time ago. She's deceased now. But she called up, I'm in Washington, she's calling from Chicago. Hi, Mom, hi. My mother said, hi, Francis. She said, I heard that you said that word in public. And I said, Mom, what? You know. I said, no, I don't. Mom, what? What? She said, Marilyn Farmer. I had never heard that before, but, you know. I said, Mom, don't worry. It's a political expression. How so? Man who calls another man the man and calls himself baby. The power of a man compared to the power of a baby. Whose power? Politics, political means the power relationship between people. Nobody has to feel bad. This is the system that we're talking about. The system of racism, white supremacy has to take power from the black male if there is going to be white genetic survival. Are you all with me?
Yes, sir.
See, now, if we begin to understand this so that we understand what we are dealing with, then we can begin to have choices about what we're going to do on the black side of the chessboard. Because white supremacy is coming down, attacking us by any means necessary. Whether they have to do it with Tuskegee syphilis experiment, HIV, AIDS, Ebola, whatever, cholera in Haiti, whatever. Or their survival. So if we don't understand the game, what in the world can we do? You see, but once black people, once black men understand the game, basketball is a game about tactics and strategy. Football is about tactics and strategy. So all the person wants to know is what's the game, how's it played, what are the rules. But we have been deceived, so we haven't understood what the game is all about. So we're floundering all over the place, not understanding and not making points, because we don't understand the system. And I maintain, for those who want to do something about this critical situation, Neely Fuller has said, there are four possible ways that a victim of a system can respond. They can submit, they can cooperate, they can resist, or they can engage in destruction of. Now, destruction of, those are the people who are already dead, like Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, the people who they're going to move in spite of the pressure. They don't mind losing their lives. I'm not advocating that. These are all individual choices. Submission means it's too much for me. Let it just roll on over. Cooperation with, just give me a job. Two figures, three figures. Resist. I'm talking about the system, so I'm resisting. If they say, Francis, we'll kill you, I'll probably jump back to you. You see, but at least to be consciously aware of what is going on. Like Neely Fuller says, who is an Uncle Tom? The person you see when you brush your teeth. That means, see how quiet, no, that's just cooperating with the system. The slave master told Uncle Tom to take some other slaves to another plantation. He didn't run away. He said, I gave my word, so I go back to the plantation. The slave master did him in, but he was cooperating. See, if you stop at a red light, you're cooperating. If you stop at the cashier in the supermarket. See, you're owed everything free. Every black person is due $several trillion for what happened to us. You see, but so you pay at the cashier. You stop at the red light. We're into cooperation with. But people can decide to resist. I say talking about what the system is really all about. Not deceiving ourselves as to what the system is actually about. And the people who keep resisting, even though they're threats to their lives, they're in a special category. This is not show-off category. It's just where the person's will and where their commitment is. And again, this is not about name-calling white people, cursing out white people. See, I was given a lecture on Thursday. I said, you know, one of the most important things we can do in relationship to people who classify themselves as white is to say, we're afraid of you all. We're afraid of you all. See how quiet it is? That means that truth, but it's not speaking out. Do we have a right to be afraid?
Yeah.
Sure. Sure. Look at this. I said, this is the problem. Perceived as the problem. When a white police officer, so-called, stops a black man and says, I thought he had a weapon. He does. It's genetic power. You see, think of all the cases. I thought he had a weapon. The man just had his wallet in his hand or his keys. I thought he had a weapon. And that's enough for the person to do what? See, this is a front view of male genitalia. This is a lateral view. If you turn that around 90 degrees, you get this. What does that look like?
Good.
And what is the gun called in the system? great equalizer. Meaning, you have weapon can annihilate me. Musk create weapon can do same thing. You see, so where is the gun war? One on each side. That's just like this. And then it's called justifiable homicide. You see, meaning anytime I see a black male and I get a little bit nervous, if I'm authorized to carry a gun, I'm authorized to kill him. Are you all with me? I see fear. Don't feel bad. This is war for white genetic survival by any means necessary. You see, but if we don't face what it is, then people are engaged in a pretense that everything is all right. But everything is not all right. We are in a state of a slide towards genocide. See, you cannot have the men from a community removed and have a people. Are you all with me? See, but white supremacy is so bold. On the front page of the Washington Post a little while ago, they said, black women, you should start, because I know the black men are all gone. So you should start dating white men. On the front page of a newspaper. Do you understand? That's just like slavery. We're killing off the black men. So, hey, you want to have a man, so-called? Get a white man. And then on the other side, they're saying, now we are unleashing a certain number of white females to go with black men. Because that will make them believe that racism and white supremacy doesn't exist. A young man came up to me on Thursday at my institute and said, I just came back from Germany, Dr. Wells. There's a lot of black men who are out of the service, and they're married to German women. He said if it weren't for the color, they got, you know, they're kind of built like black women. See, that's the Caroline Brigade. So I said, I guess you'll be going back to Germany? See, that the system has figured out. Informal slavery, when the white slave master would be rapidly raping African women, but the mother would be black, and she would tell the child, you're black. White females tell their offspring, you're not black. You're mixed. Now, what does that mean she actually is thinking about black? To say to the child, you are not black. But let him try to stop a cab. Let him try to get a job so he becomes schizophrenic. Because he has been taught by the mother to hate black. I really don't respect your father. You see, but these are all of the kinds of confusion. difficulties that go along with maintaining the system of racism, white supremacy. So every black person has a whole lot of choices to submit, cooperate, or try to destroy. So this is where we are. So what do we do? If somebody, because what we need some strong people over here, males and females alike. So if I could wave a magic wand, if I could wave a magic wand, I would say for us to fight racism and white supremacy, we need some strong people. Where do people start getting strong? When?
When you fall down.
That's not the answer I'm looking for.
Self-awareness.
They start getting strong before the sperm meets the egg.
Big death.
You know, people used to insult people by saying, you're a bird brain. You know, because birds have little tiny brains. But I say the bird knows you build a nest before you lay an egg. Are you all with me?
Yeah.
See, nobody has to feel bad. In other words, we have been victimized by a system that does not want us to be strong and functional. The system can't tolerate black people being strong, self-respecting, and functional. And so it creates where we are. But if people are going to be strong, I would say, don't chase me out. I believe in sisters. See, if I could wave a magic wand, because I'm trying to get an army over here of self-respecting black people. So I would say, black people need to be 35 as males, 30 as females. And they need to be married. Because what the system has us doing, see, we are under fire 24/7. This is stress city. At least for people to be old, because if I'm 14, 15, there's no way I can pass on strength to a child. There's no possible way. There's no possible way that I can take care of somebody for 25 years to stand them on their feet. Are you with me?
Yes.
In formal slavery, we were breeders and studs. Are you all with me?
Yeah.
And the offspring were sent away to different plantations. That's called foster care. Are you all with me?
Yes.
Yes.
I'm so sick and tired of seeing patients in foster care who were sexually abused. 10 foster homes. How can somebody come out sane? The intention for them to come out sane was not the goal. You also have, see, this is like fight back. yourself a bitch and a hoe, then it doesn't matter what happens to you. What's supposed to happen to a bitch? What's supposed to happen to a hoe? What's supposed to happen to a dog? Only response is, no, you're not. No, you're not for those who can. No, you're not. But see, we don't really have a convincing response to that. So they can, how many people have seen CNN and Soledad O'Brien talking about Jonestown? And they keep putting it on. And putting it on, and putting it on. 1,000 black people were killed. I say they had to be gassed. Following a white Jesus called Jim Jones. I say they had to be gassed because dogs don't drink Kool-Aid. And they had dogs dead. Laying with their feet up in the air. You see, and if you had drunk cyanide, you would be convulsing but not laying straight. But what they're doing is saying, now we're going to kill 1,000 of them and see how they react. Let's see, we'll kill 40. They don't react. Let's see, I've killed 2,000 in Haiti and tell them it's cholera. They have no reaction. Are you all with me? These are experimental tests. See what they do. Have we succeeded in having them repeat? Gangster. And bitch, and hoe, and nigger. And saying those are terms of endearment.
Sure.
Even we have to give the system a series of A plus. Mission. Ourselves. See, when people are working, see, if you turn on your TV in the morning, you're getting white, 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 blonde, white women, white, 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 Anderson Cooper can come on CNN and have the little children, a little three-year-old white child. How many of you saw those programs?
Yes.
Too bad the audience didn't see it. Because they gave little white children a strip with colored faces on it. You know, like white face, little tan face, all the way to a black face. Three-year-old white child. Which child is stupid? Without hesitation, the black child. Which child is ugly? Which child is bad? Without a moment's hesitation. And then they did the same thing with some black children. Beautiful little children. Which child is ugly? Black. Which child is dumb and stupid? Black. See, in both parents, the white parent and, oh, we don't know how. learns the lesson. Not to mention conversation that might go on in the household about, isn't that girl pretty? Now, was she crystal black?
No.
See, it's the vibe fell. My back is turned, but the vibe fell. See, we have to get in touch with the truth. See, little black babies, the day they're born, the family goes to the hospital, they're looking through the glass, the nurse says, this one is your, no, that must be a mistake. No, that, check the bracelet again. What does the system teach? If you're black, I can do this in London and say, if you were yellow, and if you're white,
you're right.
See, now this is just color code white genetic survival. Because the more genetic power you have, your skin is crystal black. A next lesser level of melanin production, so-called brown, slide red in there, and yellow. White is none at all. And so it stands to reason, if the system is about white genetic survival, dark has to be out. So parents bring the little children to the psychiatrist. Dr. Wellesley, my daughter, says she's going to kill herself because the boys say she's too dark to date. Are you all with me? See, we have to cure if we're going to have any response going this way. We have to cure color sickness, hair sickness, feature sickness. Are you all with me?
Yes.
Just embrace yourself. Just say, this is fascinating. I tell my patients, don't say I'm stupid. Just say, this is interesting. This behavior that I have is fascinating. The behavior is just coming from what the system is ramming 24/7 nonstop for its genetic survival. We teach them to hate themselves, and then all we have to do is bring some drugs in. Well, first we have to have unemployment. See, now it costs $45,000, $50,000 to maintain one black man in prison for a year. Why couldn't he be paid $45,000, take care of himself, a wife and two children? Oh no, we would rather have him locked up. Learn how to be a lady. Are you all with me? A person doesn't have to feel bad. No, a system is operating on us that we don't have a clue about. But we can begin to understand. Where there is no vision, the people will perish. Where there's no understanding, the people will perish. So we have to make up our minds that, wait a minute, we better understand this. Because just like Hitler said, I don't care about their religion. Talking about Semites or the Jewish religion. Read Hitler, Mein Kampf. He said, I don't care about their religion. I'm killing them because they're not white. See, we got a whole lot of black people who miscegenated and could pass for white. That's what the Semites Semites of the Jewish religion. They came out of North Africa. But if you move up into Europe and you miscegenate, we got a lot of black people. I think I'm going to have a baby by a white man because it's going to give my child a better chance. Anybody hear that before? We know all about that. So they had the same process going. They thought they were in. You see, but Germany's economy went south. Does that sound familiar? And when everybody is shaking and nervous, Adolf Hitler came on the scene. So what we're going to do is go. We're going to kill them. I'm going to kill 11 million was the number he set for him. Succeeded in killing 6 million. See, 6 million. You ever start wondering where the people who are moved out with gentrification, where are they? Where are they going? Out of sight, out of mind. And if we are in a state of not caring about ourselves, we won't even raise the question. See, we will not raise the question because, what, I don't care about myself. I don't like the way I look. It's okay if I'm dead. So, what? It's not about frightening, it's about, see, and I say this, that the creator of the universe made black people the first people. I'm not talking about a monkey. The first human beings, the first people to know about family life, the first people to know about God, the first people to know about mathematics, philosophy, architecture, engineering. And the Creator said, I made you the parents of everybody on the planet. So I think that the Creator, in a certain sense, is, okay, I'm going to test them. I'm going to have them taken through hell. And let me see whether they will rise up with what I made them to be. We are the parents of everybody, including white people. All we have to do is have a mutation to albinism, and that's white. It's a passage in the Bible. The sons of God saw the daughters of man, and they were fair. Meaning the sons of God, the crystal black people, saw the daughters that were mutations from man, and they were fair. What does fair mean?
White.
White. See, and it's just like I gave a lecture in New Hampshire a long time ago, and I told the white people, I said, you know, maybe we owe you all an apology. We black people. So maybe we were the first child abusers. Because we are the first people. How many people are reading the articles that are coming out of Africa about how black people are treating the albino mutants?
Yeah. Yes.
Mistreatment, right? So here's the huge continent of Africa. Here's the Mediterranean. Human life began right in this area. These are crystal black people. But for some reason, some albino mutants were produced. And we chased them out. And I say, that's the book of Genesis. Adam and Eve were in the Garden of Eden. They ate the forbidden fruit and became ashamed of their nakedness. See, doctors even now try to, you know, some abnormality comes about, one of the first things we want to ask the mother, what did you eat? Did you eat the forbidden fruit? So the albino mutants were pushed out and directly north of Africa as well. So they were pushed out up here, and thousands of years they collected, formed the big group. And then what did they do? They came back home and got the mothers and fathers who rejected them and took them west to America and said, now you're going to take care of the white people. Put that little black baby in a box out in the field and you're going to nurse this white baby and you're going to take care of us without charge. And then Western culture history said that Western civilization began where? Come on, class, you don't want to repeat Greece. Rome. And the founders of Rome, Romulus and Remus. And what were they doing? So if Romulus and Remus had to suckle on a wolf, that means they are foster children. Ooh. Are you all with me? And then what do Romulus and Remus start a culture that says what? The dog. See, the wolf is a canine. The dog is a canine. And the culture says the dog is man's best friend. The dog is treated better than the black people. Are you all with me?
Right.
See, and if anybody has any experience, a psychiatrist sees this all the time. Let's say a child is given up by the parent. And so, you know, the fantasy is that one day the mother and child will get back together and they will embrace and live happily ever after. But that's not what happens. There may be an initial embrace. And then what is the child's response going to be? You gave me up. Anger and hurt and mistreatment follow. So I say, you know, maybe this is the whole story. And so what do? We apologize to the white people. And say, but now, since you set up this system of injustice, we're going to stop it. So this is not going to continue. Because this is not the way that we can have peace on this planet. And we are the parent people of the planet, and we are going to take our parental responsibility. Because I can see the Creator sitting up, he, she, combination of both maybe, saying, hey, I made you all the first people on the planet. I gave you everything. Nobody is more than you. So don't call on me. I don't want to hear. I want to see whether you are in touch. I hear that black people are the most religious people. Are we in touch? See, are we in touch? You know, even the white people say, what? The most powerful thing in the universe is what? A black hole. And now they've discovered the thing that holds it all together is dark matter. Now I say that if we are hating black, see, we need to review George Washington Carver, black man, crystal black man. He said he would go out early in the morning when it was quiet, and the plants would talk to him and tell him what they could do. See, this pigment, black, is a superior absorber of energy. Everything is energy. Everything is energy. What if these cells that we wish we could get rid of, oh God, give me some more bleach. What if the Creator is saying, I gave you, they say, scientists say the melanocyte that produces this black pigment is the second most sophisticated cell in the human body, second only to the best, BETZ, cells that are in the cerebral cortex that we think with. And we can't stand it. God, please make me white. Dr. Welsing, please create a pill that if I take on Monday, it'll turn me white. And that second pill you got, that you got on eBay selling it, will give me long, straight hair. And that third pill will give me white features. See, I can charge $1 million a pill, and we would find our way to buy it. Do you all understand? And if you don't think you feel that way, ask your little children. What is mommy's favorite color of a person? What is daddy's favorite color? A little child will tell us what we think is beautiful. And so you just use that, not to shame yourself, you just use it as a corrective. You say, this is fascinating how I've been programmed under racism, white supremacy. This is absolutely fascinating. So do you all follow what I'm saying?
Yes.
People who classify themselves as white are not going to deliver us. And the question is whether we care enough about ourselves to deliver us. Well, let me stop and let you all ask.